So have you ever been put in an awkward situation that your face just goes a blur and you have no idea what to do? Like, I don't know, walking in on your parents having sex, somebody letting one go right in front of you, and so on and so on. Well, we just created a segment dedicated to those awkward looking faces. And we entitled this segment, The Gas Face Chronicles. Take a look.
I want to tear you apart. And your friend too.
Jim?
It's not what it looks like.
My name is Jesus, and I'm the best. All the DJs want to feel my breath.
We'll be right back with Keith Ice and Paradise Craig. Welcome back, everybody. So tonight, my two guests are both hip-hop legends. One is an MC, member of the legendary group Third Base, and he's also the co-curator of the Universal Hip Hop Museum. My other guest is also the architect of the X-Clan, manager of the Latin Quarters. He's a DJ, writer, author, artist, filmmaker, promoter, producer, public speaker, and he's also the chief curator of the Universal Hip Hop Museum. Let's take a look at a clip.
Stop vexing on us, cause you ain't originate. The thin ice is skate upon a break and set you straight. Ate up on the plate, now who's Diesel? Not the weasel, not the weasel. Pop goes the weasel.
Peace, my name is Paradise Gray, and I'm the artist and curator of Disappearing Black Culture in Pittsburgh. The main message of Disappearing Black Culture in Pittsburgh is to point out the actual need for preservation of the culture of African Americans in Pittsburgh. There's a great need for a council to identify and preserve cultural icons in our community.
Said I'm Pete Nice. You want my autograph? Over office closed as she heard this. She said from third base I could do this. Do listen closely, slowly took a swig of intoxicant. Cause the Brooklyn Queen's a gold digger.
Yeah, looking for Brooklyn. Yeah, looking for the Brooklyn Queen.
It is so important to partner with institutions like the Andy Warhol Museum. Andy Warhol was one of my heroes. His use of pop culture to record history is unprecedented, and I love his presentation and the simplicity of many of the messages and the art that he created. I get it. You know, I also love the way that Warhol reached out to diverse people and gave voice to people who are normally marginalized. In the same way, the Warhol Museum is continuing that tradition by working with me and the other artists on this project. They're giving access to African Americans and other people who are basically silenced by not having access to these spaces.
Gas, past tense made facially, third basal express, KMD, three blind mics on site. Zev Lover gave it the first light. A grin shows a trick up a sleeve. What a tangled web they weave. Deceive is stupefied through fable. Say let's make a deal at the dinner table.
This exhibit is basically a scream from the top of the mountain that I matter, that black culture matters and black art matters. And we have a voice. Take the time to stop some time and listen to it. I appreciate the Andy Warhol Museum for helping me to bring some air to a community that can't breathe.
Please give a warm welcome to Pete Nice and Paradise Square.
Good, good. How are you?
What up, I'm good. Did I get that all right?
Yeah, you actually got it all right. I'm proud of you.
You did.
Thanks, man.
You forgot artists. Paradise been knocking out some crazy paintings the last couple of weeks.
All right. Listen, Paradise, is there anything that you don't do? Because you like Jamaican, man. You got like 8 jobs. Like, you should be on Living Color. Just do a little segment.
Hey, where I come from, you do everything because you never know.
I definitely appreciate that. So, gentlemen, first and foremost, like everybody here is on, congratulations on so far a legendary career that the both of you has provided to this world, at least for the past, I'm going to say at least 40 years, if I'm not mistaken, because you've been rocking this thing for a long time, correct?
That's true. And for me, I've been in hip hop since I was 7 years old, and I'll be 57 this summer.
Wow, yeah, he's over. Paradise is over 40 in hip hop.
I'm older than hip hop. How about that?
That's right.
We got to ask Paradise this question. So, Paradise, what was the point, the inspirational moment that says, "I am hip hop"? Do you remember that time when that happened?
I think that it came after, like the moment that I realized that I was somebody and it meant something was the night that Grand Mixer DXT won the Grammy with Herbie Hancock. That was the moment where I became self-aware and I cried and I finally saw myself as somebody successful because I saw myself in Grand Mixer DXT and those B-boys on stage.
Yes. Wow. That's pretty crazy. I actually have DXT on in a couple of weeks. He's a really, really great guy. Really, and I'm looking forward to interviewing him.
Absolutely. My best friends and mentor.
Mm-hmm. So, Pete Nice, same question to you, brother. What was the moment that hip-hop, that you knew that I am hip-hop? What was that moment that you knew that you wanted to be in this industry for life?
Well, more so just the fact of knowing what hip-hop was. I used to be a ball boy on my father's basketball teams in the summer in New York City. And he had a lot of guys on his team from Stevenson, a lot of the schools from the Bronx, and they'd have their boom boxes just playing flash tapes and, you know, Cold Crush tapes later. But that's before the radio, before records. So I was able to hear, like, you know, what these kids were rocking on their box. And I knew from that time on, I just got hooked at an early age. And, you know, one thing led to another. And next thing you know, I'm hanging out with Paradise at the Latin Quarter. So, I mean, maybe, you know, the introduction to the Latin Quarter with my manager at the time, Lumumba, Professor X, who was Paradise's partner. For me, that was pretty much it.
Oh, man. And let me tell you something. I grew up, it's such an honor right now being able to interview so many legends of hip hop because I was one of the only kids, and I said this in season one, I was in a predominantly white school, and I was one of the only kids that really listened to hip-hop on a daily basis. I got made fun of all the time. I was wearing the chains. I had the afro going on, and I couldn't break dance for shit, but I tried. But music from the X-Clan, Third Bass, Pop Goes the Weasel, my favorite was definitely Gas Face to this day. I used to give my brother the Gas Face a lot. And he'd just be like, stop doing that. And I'm like, nah, you have no idea.
But, right.
Yeah, exactly. And with MC Search. But that you have such a long history of hip hop, the both of you. But I really want to concentrate in this interview today on something that you both have been a major part of that happened about 3 weeks ago that I had the pleasure of covering. And I first and foremost want to thank everybody that's part of the Hip Hop Museum, from Renee to Senyon to LG to Rocky Cubano. Thank you for having me there along with TBS.
AKA Rocky Rockefeller.
That's right. So thank you for having me there. Finally. It was an honor. But let's get into this. So both of you, first of all, Paradise is the chief curator. Pete Nice is the co-curator of the Universal Hip Hop Museum. Tell me about your job and the significance of what you are looking to do to make this museum as great as it is, because it's really a hall of fame for hip hop.
I don't know if we call it that. You know, the Universal Hip Hop Museum is a platform for hip hop everywhere in the world to have common ground in the place where hip hop came together as a entire genre, not just a genre of music, but, you know, as, you know, something much bigger than that. You know what I'm saying? Where the B-boying, the B-girl, you know, the DJ, the rapper, where everything comes together, all the elements come together in the Bronx as a culture. And, you know, we just want to build the bridges between generations, religions, people, cultures, and celebrate the united culture of hip hop and everything that everybody brings to the table.
I love it. I love it. And you guys are curating pretty much, meaning that you're collecting just materials from the last 40 something years from every artist that you could think of out there. How important is this job that you guys are really doing? Because this is not a part-time gig. This is literally 24/7, like pretty much like when people go out and they hunt for gold, like your job is literally go out there and find all the memorabilia from ticket sales to little flyers to posters. How important is this job that you both are taking on right now? Pete, you want to answer that?
Yeah, well, you know, as the curators, it's our, you know, job and responsibility to tell the story of hip hop from the earliest days, you know, up through modern times. And, you know, also to give the proper recognition to all those pioneers who laid the foundation, who in many respects haven't gotten their just due. I mean, no one from the early days, myself included, and I'm not even the early days with Dice, but we're from the age where people didn't get paid for their records, but the guys before us, you know, were even a point where they put in all that work every weekend at all the clubs in New York City. And, you know, you got to give respect to, you know, the Bronx, Brooklyn, Queens, even out in Long Island, you know, as the originators of this art form, this culture, you know, all the way around with the Five Elements. But, you know, it was really those DJs and the MCs who came on, you know, after that really made this what it is today. That, you know, every cat out there who puts out a record today owes a great deal to all those who came before. So we have to tell their stories, and sometimes we can do it through the artifacts that have survived that we can track down.
Which I love. Now, you mentioned something in that speech that you just did. I was speaking to Senyon Kelly, such a great lady. Shout out to Senyon out in LA right now. Can you explain to a lot of people out there, because it seems the millennials don't really know their history, right? It's something that's bothering a lot of the old school hip hop guys and the legends, which I can completely understand. Can you explain what the five elements are of hip hop that a lot of these cats really don't know about at all?
I'm surprised that there's people that don't know what the five elements are, but you got the B-boy, B-girl, you got the DJ, you have the MC, a.k.a. rapper, and you have the graffiti artist, a.k.a. Urban graphics. We have so many names for some of the elements because, you know...
Aerosol Art, you know our man, Phase 2, rest in peace.
You know what I'm
saying? He would frown upon us using the G word, but you know, it is part of the culture.
Exactly.
But
there are some sensitivities, and of course you got the fifth element, knowledge. You know what I'm saying? But like I said, these things develop over time in many different areas. But the South Bronx had a unique socio-political and economic pressure added to those elements that allowed that pressure to turn the coal of hip-hop culture into the diamond that it is nowadays, the multi-billion-dollar industry. You know what I'm saying? So those original elements, they existed from the beginning of time, and they morphed and they edited, and hip-hop is like the cultural version of Star Trek's Borg. Resistance is futile. You will be assimilated. So whatever flavor we got a hold of that added on to the dance styles, the music styles, the fashion, the culture, the slang, the way we dress, the way we walk, we sprinkled in and borrowed from every culture on earth to come up with hip hop.
Right. I love it. I love it. And part of the five elements, just the history of hip hop, a huge part of the history is dance. What's his name? Christopher Play Martin. Love that guy to death. He just created a film, And I Dance, which really celebrates all the dancers of hip hop, which he's been touring right now. And tomorrow night, part of the element, I have the honor, I'm going to be interviewing Turbo, Michael Chambers from Breakin, and Normski Scott from the Rocksteady crew together. Coast, West Coast. Yeah, East Coast, West Coast guys.
Ooh.
And that's why I'm glad you answered. What
is
that?
Turbo is not West Coast.
You should tell me that. He's out there for a while.
he's from Chicago. And
I know, but right now they're going to be like...
And they don't understand that a lot of the styles that are attributed to New York and L.A. came from Chicago with Don Cornelius and Soul Train, where it originated in Chicago. With Rerun, Fred Barry, and them, those guys are from Chicago. So there's a lot of untold stories that y'all going to have to pay attention to, because we're going to unravel the history of what people know as hip-hop. And we're going to present a whole new set of facts and artifacts to add on to the story that people think is the story of hip-hop.
Well, I'm glad you chimed in on that, because I was trying to like set you guys up to see if somebody's going to correct me on that. Because I do a lot of my research and a lot of my interviews, and I'm like, let me test these guys out. Let me see if they're real hip-hop.
You're going to come wrong if you test me and Pete. You got to come with you. This is what we do. This is the beautiful thing about it. When you was asking us about our jobs.
And That's right.
I say, damn, do we got jobs, Pete?
Yeah, right. Right.
I'm like, this is what we do. You know, me and Pete, from the time we started collecting coins, stamps, comic books back in the day, and baseball cards, we were hooked on collecting first. And then once hip-hop flyers came out and records and all these things, both of us, years apart, independent from each other, were amazed with these things and started collecting them organically.
Mm-hmm. Wow. Yeah, I can just...
Most people, like, you know, Paradise is really... like in a handful, like the earliest hip hop collectors who started, you know, grabbing the flyers when he was at a Cool Herc Jam in 1979, Flash Jams at Audubon Ballroom. Mm-hmm. And luckily enough, you know, those have survived so that, you know, they can help tell the story.
Oh, wow. Yeah, while you're collecting those, I'm collecting like Garbage Pail Kids and baseball cards.
I collected Garbage Pail Kids. I wish I still had a lot of the stuff. I had the original Marvel stickers that used to be in Wonder Bread.
Oh, man. The value of those things now must be insane.
You know?
Especially now, Stan Lee's passed away. God rest him. But, wow. That's crazy. So, let's talk about the groundbreaking. Out of all the events, and I've covered a lot of events, that event was by far my favorite event I've ever been to and covered in my life, because it was the first time in my life that I'm actually saying I was actually a part of history that day, because it was such a monumental occasion that you guys put together. And people don't realize 10 years you guys have been working on this. How excited were you the day that this thing was about to go down? Were you guys like getting butterflies the night before? Will you guys just be like, it's just another day?
I'm going to let Pete take that one, because honestly, for me, I've been in hip-hop since I was 7 years old, and it was definitely a monumental day, but I know how much work we put in and how much more work we still have to go. So it as monumental and incredible as that day was for hip-hop, for me, it was Thursday.
And you know, there was so much work that the whole team, everyone at the museum, did such a great job organizationally.
Absolutely.
And also dealing with the COVID restrictions and having that open up the day before, you know. And also, you know, we had a limit of people who could be invited, so then, you know, there's always the problem of people who didn't get invited. So, you know, we had to basically navigate through that. And you know, there was a lot of stress in that, like, you know, we don't want to get anyone mad at the museum, but it was just a reality. And, you know, when you had, you know, Flash there, you know, and then the more up-to-date artists like Fat Joe, Nas, and even, you know, LL being there with Dice's history with LL, I mean, that was pretty much full circle for him. You know, because he goes back to with LL to his earliest days at Def Jam. So, you know, to see them together, you know, with the shovel was pretty much the most special thing for me. And, you know, Dice took that shovel back to Pittsburgh and took it out to all his boys in the neighborhood. And they all got to take pictures with it. It was incredible.
Yes, sir.
Now, speaking of that, I'm assuming, I mean, I know there was somebody shooting the documentary, which I actually watched. If you guys haven't seen it, go to Universal Hip Hop Museum website. They did the documentary on it. It was a nice young lady that was shooting, and she did a really great job because I watched it actually a few times. Yeah. I'm assuming you're going to dedicate, I'm assuming you're going to dedicate a piece of the museum where you're going to have everybody lined up with the silver shovels and all that to just talk about that as well. And Pete, I'm glad you said that about the invites, because I've been seeing a lot of stuff online, really positive stuff about the museum. Obviously, you get a little negative stuff because people are like, why didn't I get invited? And I think they were missing a part, like, yeah, we want everybody to be there. There's like 1,000 hip-hop stars out there, from pioneers to legends, you know, but there was...
It was a no-win situation for the museum. But, you know, I think everybody at the end of the day, you know, realizes what was, you know, what it represented. And, you know, the... Like Paradise said, this isn't a museum for, like, 2021. It's for, like, 3,000. So, you know, it's much bigger than us and any of the artists by themselves. It's more collectively, you know, hip-hop as a whole.
Right. So it's pretty much... What I've been telling people, it's not just pioneers. This is every decade and future decades. Like, meaning there's a possibility 10 years from now, you might see a picture of Cardi B in there and a rest in peace to Pop Smoke and all these other guys that are coming out now to the future. This is going to represent, I have to assume, really the epitome of hip hop throughout the decades. Am I correct on that?
Of course. I mean, what, like the exhibit we have up right now, we started out last year with 1960 and 1970s. Now we're focusing on 1980 to 1985. In January, we're going to flip the exhibit from to 1986 to 1990. You know, so we're just creeping up and focusing on a small period of time at a time, because the actual museum is not going to have the ribbon cutting until 2024. So by the time we get to 2024, we'll probably have caught up to today's modern hip hop, you know, and we'll be along the way creating those bridges between each one of those focus points that we have at the revolution of hip hop. But once again, the exhibit that we have up right now is only equivalent to a pop-up with a short amount of history at a time, where the Universal Hip Hop Museum that's being built, that will cover the whole entire genre from beginning to where it is at the time when we do the ribbon cutting.
Wow. Now, I love that.
Right now, it's, you know, the Revolution of Hip Hop is the exhibition that's at the Bronx Terminal Market, right across the street from the construction site. So we have about 3,000 square feet packed with everything you can imagine from 1980 to 85. And the actual museum itself will have about 52,000 square feet with, I think, about 25 to 30 devoted to exhibit space. So, you know, we'll be able to expand on everything we're doing in these smaller exhibitions to, like, the full package when the museum opens in 24.
Yeah.
That's great. Now, are you guys, first of all, I interviewed one of the architects of the museum because I thought that was really important, and not just the architect themselves. It was from Marvel Designs. I interviewed landscape architecture because landscape is pretty important, especially in the Bronx, because there's buildings everywhere. So you guys are not just making this a museum. You're actually making this sort of like a cultural visitation site where people can hang out, enjoy the view of the Bronx, the water. Are you also looking to possibly build some sort of event venue there where you can actually hold concerts for hip-hop once in a while? Is that going to be in the work part of the design?
Not necessarily full concerts at the spot, because the spot is also going to have 2.5 acres of land developed all the way to the river given access to the river to Bronx residents for the first time. And it also will feature 500 apartments that will be condos that will be affordable housing owned by Black and brown people in the Bronx. So it's not just a museum, it's an entire complex.
Wow. So you're really, you're trying to build a whole great community, offering more jobs, housing. So this is not just a museum. This is really like a cultural statement to uplift the neighborhood of the Bronx right there, which is, wow, guys, congratulations on that.
That's the first brick that we're adding on to build Wakanda.
Right. And our collections head, Adam Silverstein, has a great idea to turn pretty much the whole area into a showcase for, you know, art inspired by hip hop. Speaking to a lot of the artists out there to contribute pieces for the wall, sculptures, everything under the sun. And Paradise is so in tune with, you know, art in general and all the artists out there that, you know, it should be pretty special. The spaces even around the museum.
True. Like, we want the Walmart that's near there to be the hip hop Walmart. You know what I'm saying? We want the Subway to be the hip hop Subway. You know what I'm saying? What's our other
the hip hop Home Depot.
The hip hop Home Depot. What's that other joint on the corner where we eat at?
Oh, Applebee's.
Yeah, the hip hop Applebee's. You know, we wanna flex and put out
they already got Joe Conzo's photos in there, so they got a little something going.
Resistance is futile. You will be assimilated.
That's kind of funny. So all the buildings is pretty much going to be like, yo, come over and get some gas at the hip hop like shell. And
exactly.
Come on, wait, come over and get some meat at the hip hop 7-Eleven. Like,
yep.
Buy a hot dog and get a free download. Like, come on in. Check it out. That'll be kind of funny.
That's what Adam's trying to do. So we support him.
Yeah, which is I love crazy ideas that are actually possible. Some of the best ideas out there are the ones that people are like, yeah, that can never happen. I'm like, no, creative ideas can happen if you have the right team. And that's actually really cool. So that's what made true. You guys decide on that specific area to build this entire thing? Because I'm sure you looked at tons of spaces in the Bronx. Why did you choose this location?
Well, that's a question for Rocky Buchanan, but it's kind of like asking somebody, why did they choose the person that's their wife? We don't choose a wife, but wife chooses us. That Bronx Point area with L&M developers, they chose us. You know, we were bouncing around for about 8 years, you know, trying to figure out a great home for the museum. You know, Rocky and the original crew that came up with the original concept for the museum, they started out at the spot that we just renamed Scott LaRock Boulevard, right? Right, Pete? Right over by what's the name of that first facility over there? It was the Bronx Armory.
Yeah, it was over by the PAL too, over by Jerome. Yeah.
So right. We started out, you know, building with the people from that armory. Those people decided that they wanted to go a different direction and it didn't fit. Then we went to the Bronx County Courthouse and that was okay for a minute and then that didn't fit. And then L&M got in touch with Rocky and it's a wrap from there. It was a perfect fit, you know, it had the perfect location and you know, we made it crack from there. You know, I just thank Rocky and all of the great executives that bust their butt and work hard behind the scene to work with the politicians and the developers to come up with this spot.
Yeah, and it's an amazing spot. The view is gorgeous and I don't think people understand the hard work, seriously, that you guys put in. Like, when it finally got developed, it was 10 years, right? Like I mentioned before. And you guys got Microsoft, one of the biggest companies on the planet, to, I believe, drop $5 million to get you guys off the ground. And then I believe Fat Joe, Nas, LL, they all donated millions of dollars as well. That's the main reason why they were there. I mean, when you got this funding for this, what was your feeling behind that? Like, wow, this is really happening. All our hard work is now coming into fruition. How did you feel when you started getting these phone calls from the guys like Fat Joe and stuff like that?
All right, once again, that's over our pay grade. That's the great work of Rocky Buchano and our executive team, our lawyers, and our board of directors. They put that work in, and I think it was only Microsoft didn't just jump in with that big check. You know, they've been working with us for years. You know, right. Including visioning sessions where we traveled around the country to L.A., Atlanta, Chicago, Detroit area, New York area, and we did these visioning sessions, and they've been riding with us for a while and contributing along the way and watching how we use those contributions to develop. And it's right. A perfect fit because, we're not just going to put just two-dimensional photos of artifacts and displays up in there. You know, we're going to be using AI and all kind of incredible technology developed by Microsoft to power the Universal Hip Hop Museum, which will be available not just by walking into a brick and mortar museum, but using amazing new technologies that people haven't even seen yet, you know, to deliver this content and full multimedia, from audio to video to photos. And it's going to be amazing the way we use this technology going forward.
Oh, yeah. And even 3 years from now, technology is going to even be excelling beyond our means that we don't even know about that may come in. Like you may just have people just popping up out of nowhere like, hey, we can do this, we can do that. And I think that would be kind of amazing. Of course, I got to ask you those questions because my old thing is you never know what's above somebody's pay grade. Like when you're on the board, a lot of people just know.
I'm just trying to, to give people the credit where credit is due. You know what I'm saying? So
yeah.
The question that you asked that, someone else put in the bulk of that work, even though me and Pete are on the team with everybody. You know, we have the utmost respect for each other. You know,
of course. And who's that guy? Rocky Buchano? Who's that guy?
Tell him about DJ Rock.
Cool, so, DJ Rock. Rocky is funny because when we collect and track down some of the flyers, we got flyers with Rocky when he was Cool DJ Rock. And, he was a relative of Pete DJ Jones. So he was in this group called the Come Off Crew, and he was like the main DJ at the Stardust in the Bronx. So, Rocky has his own history in the development of hip hop, which, is also respect to him. And, Rocky did have, the dream to build a hip hop museum, and, really 50 years into hip hop existing. Yeah. Yeah. There is no real museum in the entire world to honor hip hop and preserve the culture and the history.
Absolutely.
So it's just such an important thing. And even, our boy Van Silk, who was one of the early promoters, he actually really put into the press, like he had an idea for the hip hop museum back in 1993, 94. Mm-hmm. And he opened up his store on 125th Street. So he had his whole collection up there. And, it took someone like Rocky to, actually make it come to fruition. And like Paradise says, 10 years, Paradise brought me onto the project, like maybe 6 years ago when they were trying to get the courthouse in the Bronx.
Right.
And, we've seen like the progression, and it was, a slow progression, but sometimes the slower progressions bring you more rewards.
Absolutely.
In the end. And that's really what's happened here.
Yeah. Also to give Rocky another point on his bullet point on his bio and resume, he also was an independent label owner and studio owner as Jazzy J's partner with Strong City Records and Strong City Studios. They introduced Masters of Ceremony, which introduced Grand Poobah to the rap world.
Right. We actually just tracked down one of the first flyers from Broadway International with Masters of Ceremony doing their first record, Crime.
That's crazy. This job that you guys have, you're literally like gold hunters. Like you're trying to find treasures of hip hop.
Yeah,
I'm gonna get a phone call. I'll be like, yo, Todd, listen, me and Paradise, right? We going to China. We got this map, and apparently there are tickets from 1975 like unknown concert, and it's gonna be in this pyramid. You down? I'm gonna be like, yeah, let's do this, man. It'll be like a new Indiana Jones movie. It'll be great.
And we're definitely getting those calls. I just got a call the other day from Almighty KG from the Cold Crush, and he was down with DJ Smokey and the Smokatrons and the Luckatrons from Grand Avenue in the Bronx. And that was, they were DJing 73, 74, 75, and they battled Cool Herc at the PAL, and supposedly the actual Macintosh amps that were in that battle are in a garage somewhere upstate New York. So that's one of the things on our list to track down to bring back to the Bronx.
Yeah.
Oh, man.
And you said it'll make a movie. It'll make an even better TV show. And
oh, God. Exactly. I would love to see like a live broadcast like once a week from the Hip Hop Museum, like a show. Coming live from me. Yeah, I would love to see something like that, having guest people. That would be amazing. What I love about your job is, and I go to a lot of hip-hop events. I do all industries, not just hip-hop, because hip-hop's like 10% of everything else in the world, like acting, everything else. But what I love about this museum, and you guys can correct me on this, there are so many movies out there from Netflix or anything else that are constantly leaving out certain elements of people that were involved in the story, right? When I go online and I go on the media, there are people taken out that's not mentioned that were a part of that group. This museum is going to open up the eyes to so many stories that nobody has ever heard of. And one I'll say is, and I'll say it because she's a friend of mine, Spinderella, right? There's a huge backstory besides Salt and Pepper, right? There's a huge backstory with that, with the original Spinderella to Dee Dee. And that's something I would love to see in the museum with everybody else from Grandmaster Flash and the Five and everybody. And that's what I'm loving what you guys are doing, because this is going to open up the eyes to a lot of people.
Right.
Correct?
And which Spinderella are you talking about?
I'm talking about LaToya Hansen, DJ original Spinderella from Hogwarts.
Spinderella. There was a girl before her called Pamela Green, who was from the hybrid section in the University Projects, and also used to date Van Silk.
That's right. Well, she's got so many names. I said LaToya Hansen, but you gave the government name, so I'm going to let you handle that one. What?
And if you go to the Revolution right now, we have the earliest Salt and Pepper artifacts, which is the master for the first song Showstopper with their original promo pictures when Quicksilver was their DJ before they got into Spinderella. So, you know, that's when Herbie was actually in the group and they called themselves Supernature before they were just Salt and Pepper.
Wow.
Supernature featuring the Salt and Pepper MCs.
Yep. And when I first met Herbie, it was at the FIFA, and he was with DJ Quicksilver and the Super Lover MC, which included
Play was in the Super Lovers. Kid was in the Turnout Brothers with Ron Lawrence.
Right.
Shout out to Ron. Hey, shout out to my man Big D. I see him in the comments from Ultra. Yeah. Shout out to him and Easy Mo B.
Yeah.
That's that boy. That's a Latin Quarter regular right there.
And you know.
I can see that. So, like you said before, I think it was funny when you're like, when Paradise goes to be like, wait, we have a job? How great is it that you guys are really doing something, not just hip-hop that you did in the past, right? But now you're doing something that you're so passionate about, right? You were collecting these things for years, and now it's becoming an iconic mark that's going to be there forever, and you two are the gentlemen that's bringing it. What is your feeling beyond that? Because this is, like you said, this is bigger than all of us. Like, the world is going to see this.
Let me tell you how it feels to be doing this with Pete, of all people. You know,
yeah, great guy.
When I met Pete, he was in high school being managed by who would become Professor X, the overseer of X-Clan and the Black Watch movement. And for where we come from, you know, for to the East Blackwoods, where X-Clan, we spent half the time just in third base. So now in the age of Trump, to be unified with Pete to be building a Universal Hip Hop Museum in the Bronx is almost unreal. It's a great pleasure, and I just want to give Pete great thanks and props, you know, for being there for me as my eyes, as I went blind, that Pete was a guy in hip hop that stepped up and merged with me and, you know, has been in the trenches with me every moment for over 4 years, like really busting his hump to make this a reality. Mad props to my man, Pete Nice.
No, thank you, Dice, and props to you because, you know, you brought me onto this project and, you know, and we had that history going way back to the days of the Latin Quarter and with Lumumba and all those crazy days of Scratch Me Productions out there. So, you know, we definitely had the history and, you know, for Dice to have overcome, you know, losing his sight, you know, like he's the only, as far as I know, the only blind curator in the world. I mean, I don't know of any other. And it's like, he's got the vision, even though he can't see. His vision ain't blurry, you know, when it comes to hip hop. And, you know, I could talk about a flyer or a photograph and, you know, Dice still sees it. So, you know, that much respect to Dice for all he's gone through and, you know, to what he's become as the first blind curator.
Which is crazy. And at the end of the day, when it comes to passion, you don't need to have eyes to feel the love that you have for hip hop. You don't need to push. Music is what you hear. It's what you feel. And Paradise, I'm going to tell you right now, we see you, bro. So we'll be your eyes, man, because we see and we see what both of you are doing. And it's pretty, pretty amazing. And I'm going to thank you for that. I'm going to represent. I grew up in partly Queens, but I'm from Long Island. So I'm representing right now from Long Island. So I'm going to say thank you for a lot of the stuff you guys are bringing back out, because I'm excited to read about half the stuff I don't even know about. I'll be honest with you. I'm going to be like, what? That didn't happen.
All right. You know, and we rep, you know, Long Island, Strong Island represent. We just tracked down a flyer of Freddie Fox and the Supreme Force from 85. So, you know, we're digging for those gems and, you know, trying to tell those stories out there. And the Long Island story is a great story in hip hop and in the evolution. And we'll really, in our next exhibition, 86 to 90, we'll really come, you know, full circle with Rakim and just everybody from Long Island doing that thing.
Oh, yeah, like Chuck D and EPMD and all those.
Oh, yeah, exactly.
So before we go, we got a couple of minutes left. I'm going to ask you both each a question. Your job is obviously amazing, collecting all the stuff. So Paradise, what is the one collectible that you have that pretty much stands out from all the rest that people are like, wait, what? Can you think of something right now that you notice you're going to put in a museum that's going to blow people's mind away?
I have video footage of Tupac with X-Clan in Oakland, California. He had on a bootleg Reebok Tupac jacket, Digital Underground jacket, that he had made himself. And it was before he even spit on I Get Around with Digital Underground. So he, in that video footage, he's walking with Sonny Carson, talking to him about his career and his album and what he wants to do with himself. And then he's speaking about Assata Shakur in front of a high school class, and he's so shy to speak that Professor X had to yell at him to get him to speak. And
well, you know, no one in the class knew who he was, so he had to say, "My name is Tupac."
He had to spell it. They said, "Who are you?" He had to spell Tupac for them, and it was just an incredible piece of history and footage that, had I not recovered that piece of footage, it would have been lost forever. And nobody would even have believed this story.
Oh, wow. I can't wait to see that. Pete, what about you, brother? What do you got that we don't even know about?
One of the things that we tracked down with the help of my man Brandon Himmel, we actually tracked down the master tape for Roxanne's Revenge when she did the promo for Mr. Magic. And they laid down the promo for the Magic show on BLS and then turned that into the actual first record. And with that actual reel was the tracking sheet from Power Play Studios, which was signed by Vaughn Mason, who was, you know, a legend in his own right. Exactly. And he was the engineer, but on the back of that track sheet was all the bullet points that Roxanne was going to rhyme about. in Roxanne's Revenge. So, you know, for women in hip hop, that's like an artifact that's just, you know,
the Holy Grail.
Mind blowing.
Holy Grail. Yeah.
Exactly. There are lots of Holy Grails out there, but there's that type of material for like almost every artist out there.
Yeah.
And we just got to dig and try to find it.
Let's see if we can help you out. Obviously, you guys are connected with pretty much everybody, but if there's people out there that may have some hip-hop material that is not technically in hip-hop, is there a way that they can contact you through an email source or anything that can be like, hey, Pete, I actually have this. Can I donate this to the museum? Is there some way they can contact you at?
Yeah, the best way that people have been doing it, Adam Silverstein, who's the head of collections and archives, he's gotten a lot of the donations to the museum, and you can get on the UHHM.org website, and there's a whole section there where you can, you know, correspond and tell Adam what you have, and then he brings it along to our team and put it under consideration.
Oh, that's amazing. So, gentlemen, before we go, each of you, I always got a lot of things rolling in my head. Is there an inspirational statement that you can tell to a lot of these youngins that are getting the hip-hop game from one of the old-school legends? Is there some advice that you can give some of these guys?
I definitely have it.
Bring it.
When I was 15 years old, well, ignore us old heads when we criticize y'all on some level. When I was 15 years old, I didn't give a damn what somebody's grandfather thought about my music or what I was doing. Ignore ignorant old people on the porch telling you to get off their lawn. Hip hop is young people's music. Do it your way. Learn where it comes from, but don't let anybody stand in your way to create new styles, new dance styles, new lyricism. Whatever you want to do, you don't need nobody permission to do a damn thing. You don't need nobody to pass you no torches. All you need is somebody to pass you the damn mic or pass you the turntables. Do you, young man, but learn your history, and it'll benefit you better because you'll learn our mistakes. And when they said that you learn from mistakes, nobody said it had to be your own mistakes. Learn from our mistakes. And if you get an opportunity to latch on with a legend or pioneer, then latch on with them, learn your history. But history happens every day. Create new history. Don't just stay stuck in the past, because no matter what anybody say, y'all smarter than us and y'all better than us. And if y'all not better than us, it's not because you ain't good. It's because we didn't teach you what you need to know for you to excel. Do your thing.
I love it. I love it. Pete, you want to follow that?
Yeah, and hard to follow that. But what I will add is that, you know, hip hop itself, even old cats like us have done a poor job in preserving the history, telling the stories so that some of these young kids can actually have, you know, more perspective on where everything came from and maybe enrich what they're doing now. But, you know, like I said, hip hop has always been fueled by the youth. That's where all the innovation comes. And, you know, that's just going to continue and repeat itself, you know, like Paradise said, into like the 3000. So, you know, that's the main thing I could say to add to what Dice said, which, you know, is, you know, pretty much enough said right there.
Oh, I love it. So, guys, if you don't know by now, I've been talking with Paradise Greg and Pete Nice, Chief Curator and Co-Curator of the Universal Hip Hop Museum. Gentlemen, I want to thank you for being on FaceTime with Todd Wharton, and I hope you guys have a great night.
And I see Big D on there saying that he's got ultra material, so we'll definitely be hitting Big D up.
And
no
you
doubt.
Know this Big D. He didn't say little D. He said Big.
Yeah, right. We remember Little D out there. That was a guy who you saw everywhere. He's in every picture somewhere.
You know,
in the Paradise Collection, you see Ultra, you see D in there. It's incredible.
Yeah, absolutely.
Oh, man, that's great, man. Well, I want to thank our guests for being on tonight. Also, thank the audience going to be here for the future. And, gentlemen, be safe. I hope you guys are doing well. Hope you're healthy.
If we could give what one last shout out, we'd like to thank all our co-creators and all our content providers for helping us out. You know, Senyon Kelly, Martha Diaz, Popmaster Fable, LG, Ron the Retro. Throw some more in there, Pete. Take it out.
Yeah, we had a lot of guest curators for this exhibition. Charlie Ahern from Wild Style, Michael Holman, Monica Lynch from Tommy Boy, Short Shot LaRock, Brandon Himmel, Edon, Cut Chemist, you know, and Sal from Disco Fever. Sal Abatella from Disco Fever basically gave us a mini museum to put in our exhibition museum. So shout out to Sal. I know he was just in an accident. Hope he's feeling a lot better and hopefully gets a quick recovery of voice, Sal.
Peace to Bill Adler, Joe Conzo.
Exactly. Joe Conzo, too, as well. A lot of his photos are blown up on the wall, you know, onto the wallpaper, which is, you know, just incredible. So we want people to come out to the Revolution. We're open right now from starting in July, open Thursday through Sundays. And you just go on the UHHM website and reserve your ticket and your spot right on the website.
There it is.
There it is. Gentlemen, thank you so much. And thank you for everything that you're doing. And thank you. Thank you for the Universal Hip Hop Museum. And I wish you guys much success when this thing opens up. Thank you for being on FaceTime with Todd Wharton, gentlemen.
And thanks for your support. Thanks for the support.
Yes, my pleasure, guys. Have a great night, gentlemen.
Please. All right, peace.
So I want to thank Pete Nice and Paradise Gray for being such inspirational guests. And gentlemen, congratulations to you and your team for 10 years of hard work to finally get to the groundbreaking ceremony of the Universal Hip Hop Museum. I'm sure a lot of people are excited about that. And of course, thank you to my live virtual audience. Now coming up tomorrow night, I have two hip hop dance legends. We have Michael Chambers, who's very well known as the role of Turbo in Breakin' 1 and Breakin' 2 Electric Boogaloo. And then we have Normski Scott, who's one of the original B-Boys that you can see on Flashdance, and he's also part of the legendary Rocksteady crew. Guys, I hope you have a great night. Be safe, and like I always said, if you're not living a passionate life, then whose life are you living? Take care, everybody. Hey guys, thanks for watching. And while you're here, you might as well subscribe to my YouTube channel. And for more information on the show, go to FaceTimeWithToddWharton.com.
So what are you doing in there?
Ma, I'm shooting a promo. Why you always gotta ruin my flavor?